out of your way and love on your brother and your sister. Show them the love of Jesus Christ. Leave no one untouched. No one. Make sure everyone is shown love. Everyone standing. Hold someone's hand, bow your heads again. Because where I'm going tonight is a little touchy. Yes, sir. Bring me down just a little bit. Hold that hand and bow your heads. Now, God, I need you to anoint their ears. I need you to make their hearts fertile. I need those that are watching to tune in with their spirit and not with their carnal senses. For Lord, this is a subject so far you have given me 9 teachings on, and you are still not finished. What is your will? What is your purpose? What is your plan? That you're keeping a man like you did Noah, talking about rain. Have thine own way. Wish I had a communicating church. Have thine own way. You're the potter and I'm the clay. Mold us and make us after thine will. While we're yet waiting, we're yielded. We're still. So, God, let your word come alive. Let it do to us what it did to your son. Let the word become flesh. And let us walk it out when we leave this temple. This I ask in the mighty name of Jesus. Let's clap our hands with excitement and enthusiasm. Be seated. Shabbat, we have visitors tonight. I said, Shabbat, we have visitors tonight. I'm always happy when someone leaves their residence and comes to dine at this kingdom restaurant. I don't count it. I don't take it for granted. I just left, for those who watch, we just left Augusta, Georgia. Did anybody stay connected while we were gone? And I would like hand claps for these people that I'm about to name, and then I'll do it again on Sunday. But I don't wait till Sunday, because what if God comes tonight? But I want to thank God for Brother Kevin Gillard assisting us Thursday, Friday, Saturday, I don't hear nobody, and Sunday. He did it on his own dime. Rented his own car, paid for his own Airbnb, and allow 3 people to stay with him. I think that's a generous young man. For the first time in a while, I took one of our resident church musicians with me on the road. I enjoyed him. He's humble. He's able to take criticism. He's able to take rebuke. He learned some things, but he was a wonderful addition to the trip. Brother Bruce. Y'all clap better. He served. He was easy to deal with. And he played till heaven got better. I want to thank God that I also was blessed to have three of our leaders with us on Thursday and Friday. Executive pastor was there. Our assistant pastor was there. And senior father was there, along with a coalition of my sons and daughters and Bishop of the Shabak family and network. They were also present. I got out early enough to watch a woman who says she don't want a pastor act like she want her church back. Oh yeah, she want it back. She just don't want the responsibilities. But did not she preach the word of God on Sunday? And you that continue to only be stuck on one pastor, you're making us a cult. Hold that music. Don't you dare stay home while I'm away. That lets me know your heart is not in the right position. We have two great voices, executive pastor and associate pastor, and they are full of the word of God, and we should want to hear, thus saith the Lord. Amen? We're not a celebrity church, even though I'm a celebrity when I'm not with y'all. You laugh if you want to, I am. I'm as known as Stevie Wonder, I promise you. But the issue is we don't get caught up with those type of things. Because with notoriety comes attacks. But she did an excellent job on Sunday. I will do my best, because I forgot that I had to dedicate a new church. While we were there, we went to our home church in Augusta, but we opened up a new church in Wren, Georgia. So that's why I had to go, because it was the dedication service with the mayor and with the chief of police. We prophesied to both, and one of them joined the ministry. And so I think we need to applaud that. Let us just be fair. Your pastor is a bishop. I have a plethora of responsibilities. I have other things I have to do, but I give you most of my time. At least 40 Sundays a year and at least 40 Wednesdays a year, I am here with you all. And you that didn't clap, you can go somewhere. Because it's obvious you don't know the value of a pastor nor the responsibility of a bishop. All right, but I appreciate you all. I will miss one Wednesday coming up. I will not be here. When I know it, I tell you, I didn't know Sunday, but I won't be here on fifth Sunday. That's our youth, but I want the church packed. I'll be preaching for my bishop, the presiding bishop of the Church of God in Christ, Bishop J. Drew Sheard, on June the 30th. So I definitely will not be able to be with you. All right, because I have a leader also. Amen. And I will be watching you because he wants me finished in 50 minutes every time I go there. So I think he just loves my company and wants to hear what the Lord is saying about certain things. Amen? Amen. So I appreciate you. The shirt I'm wearing, what does this say, John? Read it for me. Pastor, Read it again, John, so they know now. I just wanted to see if you knew how to read. But this shirt was facetiously purchased by my deacon, Mays Etherwood. Stan Etherwood's Mays. Etherwood's Mays. Oh, no, don't blame your wife. I'm blaming you. So some of his business will end up in my sermons. He paid for it. We might as well use him. But I'm glad that people are humorous and love their leader. And I'm glad that we can all get along in a social way. Amen? Amen. Visitors. This person said they met me, wow, at Rhema conference. Do you know how long ago there was a Rhema conference? Jesus crap, miracles happened too. It was crazy. They're from Tacoma, Washington. Gary Wyatt, where are you? I want to see you. Can we clap for Brother Gary Wyatt? Now, come on, sustain that. You don't know how far your pastor's resume goes, but Rhema Conference was one of the greatest conferences in that day and time, equivalent at that time to what we call Woman Thou Art Loose. Before there was a Loose, there was a Rhema Conference. And it was spectacular. Online viewers came here today. They are from New Jersey. Both of them are ministers of the gospel. Minister Sharice York and Minister Hassan Kirby, where are you? Can we love on them? What part of Jersey? Newark. Yeah, I used to do a lot of preaching out there. Especially when Bishop Chandler Owens was living. And we were on Martin Luther King Drive, High Street, whatever y'all call it now. And then there was another church down there. I can't remember. Praise Tabernacle, something. Bishop Nathan Simmons back in the day. Bishop Nathaniel Simmons. Not y'all Simmons, another Simmons. Amen. A greater Simmons than your Simmons back in that day. No, really, Nathan Simmons, your Simmons, used to ask to run revivals for their Simmons. And we had a great time there. Natalie was there. Joel was there. They've asked me to come in the summer, so we're headed to Newark, New Jersey. Let's clap for our visitors from Newark, New Jersey. By way of announcement, if it goes through by tomorrow, on July 28th, I will not be here. But I do want y'all to watch me. I will be the keynote speaker at New Birth in Atlanta, Georgia, with Dr. Jamal Bryant. So I want you all to know. On November the 8th, the highlight night of the National Church of God in Christ, your bishop is the keynote speaker on November the 8th for the Church of God in Christ Holy Convocation. Unless things change now, but so far that is already written in stone. We have a visitor who is a guest of one of our good members, Rennis Akinstan. Let's clap for Rennis. His guest hails from this city. It's Tyrone White II. Where are you, Tyrone? Can we love on Brother Tyrone in that section? One of my sons are here tonight. He came in. He just wanted to see me, wants to hug, talk, wanted to sow seed. He has a growing ministry in the state of Maryland. It's bilingual there. You would know him at times by way of his brother-in-law and his biological sister, Overseer Brian and Overseer Andrea Dean. Andrea is his biological sister. Are you the older? The youngest. He's the baby, but he acts like he runs things. But he is here with us tonight just to share his presence. I want us to thank God for God's servant and pastor, Les McIntosh. He's a prophet of God, and he walks strong in the apostolic creed. He's about setting up ministries and making sure that they are biblically astute and biblically sound. I think we should clap better for his presence tonight. And now for my special guest, Jesus Christ, the Son of the Living God. Get your Bibles. This is my ninth. This is a ninth part of this series on sin. I believe a lot of folk ain't coming because they're sinful. But I prefer that over being full of sin. Talk to me early. Some of us are acting deep, but you have sinned since you've been born again. All right, I have. Because some of you ain't going to admit it till I do, but it's okay. I've been saved and filled with the Holy Ghost going on 42 years. There's no way I lived holy all 42 years. I gave it a shot, though. And just when you say, I would never do this, never do that, never do this, one of those things spring up on you. Talk to me. And now you live for a season in a state of embarrassment. Now, I want to make this easy tonight. For all of you that have never sinned, you are dismissed. You can go home tonight and no one would say anything negative about you. But if any man said he have not sinned, this ain't my take, this scriptures, he is a liar. No, it says, and the truth of God is not in him. But if any man sin, God is faithful and just, y'all don't like this, to forgive us of our sins, and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Now, I can't believe my prophetic is on, but two of you, one is my member, believe you have not sinned since you've been saved. You need another church. You need to leave here tonight and not come back. If any of us could live saved and holy and make no mistakes all of our salvation walk, then the Lord would have killed you instead of himself. He's the perfect sacrifice. He was tempted like us. The Bible said he became sin, but he sinned not. If any of you can sin not, his trip was wasted. Don't you ever compete or compare yourself to Jesus Christ. Touch somebody and ask them, what is your name? See if they say Jesus. Find out what their name is. What's y'all's name over there? What's your name? What's your name? All right, okay, I want to make sure. I know some may call you wonderful. When you read scriptures like the effectual fervent prayer of the righteous availeth much, there are scriptures before that that basically activates that scripture. The scriptures that activate it, for some of you who will talk to me, is simply this. It says, pray for your brothers. It says, confess your faults one to another Y'all quiet. Then pray for each other. And when you do that, the effectual fervent prayer of the righteous, that prayer is not for you, it's for your brothers. Come on, talk to me on the right, middle, left. It's for your brothers who right now are not living up to par. And then it says, if you love them enough to pray for them, I hope somebody scream on this, it says their sins will be forgiven. And they will be healed. Church is sick and unforgiving because we have a church full of uncaring individuals. I still have three members who see so many demons. I wonder why you can't see angels. Why can you see all these spirits but can't see the Holy Spirit? Why you see what's wrong with everyone but can't find that one thing that's right? What is wrong with you? If you saw a diamond in a pound of feces, I bet you wouldn't look at the feces long. You'd be like, is that a diamond I see in the dung? And some of you would miss the value because you try to wait till everybody leaves so they don't see you playing in the mess. I'm actually not playing in the mess. I'm reaching for what's valuable. You better not ever come to me and say you see spirits around me. You better hold that testimony. Because there has to be spirits around me because the devil's after anyone that's anointed. But the more attention you give him, the more power he receives. If God be for us, I don't hear y'all talking. If God be for us. All right. Romans 6. Verse 23, Romans chapter 6, verse 23, and then we're going to the book of James, chapter 1, and then we will end up somewhere in the book of Job. All of you that are just here for a prophecy, we on strike. You got to come on Sunday, and sometime we don't give it then. I'm not going to prophesy whether your boyfriend going to marry you or if he's gay. That's just not my business. If you don't know as a woman, he ain't yours. Romans 6, verse 23. Can we pause and clap for our e-church members? I love them. For the wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. This is going to be a good one, y'all. For the wages of sin is death. But the gift... And somebody came to judge me. I want to know if he's a real prophet. Does he preach against sin and homosexuality? Why don't you do it? Why you want to choose my authenticity, my authenticity by what I preach against? What if your children are gay? What if you're undercover yourself? If you want folk delivered, live the life that you're supposed to live in front of them. People need, talk to me, five members. We need God's word wrapped up in flesh. Somebody has to be living it. For the wages, the payment, the stipend, y'all didn't remember last week, of sin is death. The gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. And that's period. And I said last Wednesday, oh, I'm going to fix this here tonight. Sin wants your wages. Look at somebody and tell them, sin wants our wages. James chapter 1, verses 12 through 15. When we get to the Message Bible, we will begin at verse 13 through 15. James chapter 1, verses 12 through 15. Blessed is the man that endureth temptation. For when he is tried, he shall receive a crown of life, which the Lord hath promised unto them who love him. Do I have a church? Let no man say when he is tempted, I am tempted of God. For God cannot tempt man with evil, neither is God tempting any man. My left side is quiet again. But every man is tempted. Every man is tempted. Every man is tempted. And you're tempted, let me read it, when he or she is drawn away of their own lust and then enticed. Then when lust hath conceived, it bringeth forth sin. So lust is not the sin. Temptation is not the sin. It's what you do with the temptation. It's whether you fulfill the desire of lust. Come on, Shabbat, come on. I haven't seen y'all in a while. When he's drawn away with his own lust and then enticed. Verse 15. Then when lust has conceived, it bringeth forth sin. And when sin is finished, it bringeth forth death. Put this in the Message Bible. Let's get some clarity. You shouldn't be afraid of this topic anymore. You should be well versed. Since I've been preaching it until now, you may have sinned, but not as often. If you still sinning the exact same way, something wrong with you. James 1, 13 through 15. Don't let anyone under pressure to give in to evil say, God is trying to trip me up. God is, I like these words, impervious to evil and puts evil in no man's way. Let me read the rest because y'all not talking. The temptation to give in to evil comes from us and only us. If you're grown, say amen. We have no one to blame but the leering, seducing flare of our own lust. Here we go. Lust gets pregnant. Has a baby called sin. Sin grows up to be an adult and becomes a real serial killer. I'm going to reread that because that sounds more like the Z's and Alpha's language. But it's also the language of some of you who don't read the Bible at all. Don't let anyone under pressure to give in to evil say, it is God that's tripping me up. God is impervious to evil and puts evil in no one's way. Do I have help here? Son, you're pretty late. The temptation to give in to evil comes from us
and only us. We have no one to blame but the leering, seducing flare. I wish you would take responsibility of our own lust. Lust gets pregnant. Has a baby. The baby is called sin. Sin then grows up to become an adult. And I want to add a word to this because it's the Message Bible, and becomes a serial killer. It's good to see a guest church in the back. Living Waters Christian Church just came in all the way from Columbia, South Carolina. They brought 15 members with them and they drove all the way here. Can y'all clap? Dr. Sanders, stand up so we can see you. Where's Dr. Sanders? Clap for Dr. Sanders. Look at people driving and coming to service. Isn't it something? You live right around the corner. It's my favorite day. The whole subject is about sin, but the topic tonight, for those that I want to help who will talk to me, is the price is too high. Look at three or four people, articulate that to them, look them in their face because you ain't scared, and tell them the price is too high. You don't make enough money to keep sinning. You can save money for 10 years and in one sinful act lose 10 years of money. You are not wealthy enough to continue sinning. Now, I'm going to make a statement because y'all ain't talking. Broke folks sin often because they have nothing to lose. But they always sin with people that have a lot to lose. You get a woman that has nothing to lose. She approaches a man that's highly anointed, me or any one of you, and she says, even though you're a preacher, you're still human. You got to watch them conversations. Don't you have needs too? Yeah, but it ain't you. I got needs, right? But anybody that can talk in the opposite direction of your purpose and your reason for being, you need to avoid. Anybody that comes in your life quick and tell you what is your weakness. Why you want to know my weakness? Superman would have been fine if he didn't tell Lois who he was. Love will make you give out information you should have kept. All right, I'm just going to go on. I love you, but not enough to tell you everything. Not going to happen. You don't have to tell me yours. I'm a prophet. I already know it. The price is too high. Let's change that and see if you'll be friends with your neighbor. Tell him it's as simple as I have too much to lose. Tell him. And y'all ain't gonna catch this. You don't even have much now, but the prophecy is that you will. So I cannot afford to lose it before I get it. Some of you have lost it before you even obtained it. You are in debt to the future that you don't even have yet. You've made so many mistakes in the past, you're in debt till tomorrow. Tell somebody and tell them, I got to get out of this sin debt. I have to get out of this sin debt. Let me read, and all of this is me here tonight. We must understand that as we become mature in our walk with God, that we understand that God does not set us up to fail. You that didn't say something, hopefully it's because you're listening, But you that did is because you believe what I said. The Lord did not set you up in that marriage to be beat up by any man or buy you a new car and it got wrecked next week. None of that has anything. See, some of y'all still have your head bowed. You're talking about God was testing you. You are not tempted of God. There's a difference in God causing it and God allowing it. And let me talk like a mature Christian. I accept what God allows, even though I don't like what he allowed. Y'all ain't talking. There's nothing you can do about changing the plan of God except live through it. Look at your neighbor and tell them the mere fact that you're here tonight lets me know that you've survived some things. Failure to an extent is a part of success as long as you learn from those mistakes. Let me talk to this side that ain't talked again. Failure to an extent is a part of success. Only when you learn from the mistake you made. My next question is an hypothesis. It's very eisegetical. Could sin in any way lead us towards righteousness? My answer to that is not definitive, but it is to be investigated. Maybe it is if you lose enough. Is there anyone tonight tired of losing things? If you don't say amen, you ain't real. I cannot afford to lose another thing for anyone. Not my mother, not my children. I told my child tonight, you go down, you going down by yourself. And I mean every word. You got righteousness in your reach. You got wisdom in your corner. And you ignore it and fail. You are going down by yourself. Because you're entertaining lust. Lust is having a baby called sin. And sin is growing up and will wipe you out. The reason why it's hard to stop sinning. Can I be transparent? Well, 10 of you talk to me because I miss you. The reason why it's hard to stop sinning is because sin is enjoyable. Y'all been lying. God saved me from a miserable life of sin. Not me. Not me. Not I. Not I. Proper English. Not I. Oh, the Bible disagrees with you because it said for a season sin is pleasurable. So how do you call something miserable that the Bible says for a season is pleasurable? Oh, executive pastor said you didn't know how to sin properly. So let's come back. I ain't never smoked or drank when I was a sinner. You didn't know how. You didn't have the right stuff. Because you don't start smoking weed by puffing. You get a contact from being around it. You don't see how y'all quiet. And folk in the back, I didn't come to hear this. You smoke weed. I know you do. I used to sell it, and I know my clients. Well, mine is medicinal. I don't care. Someone gave me some medicinal weed last night. They don't know the extent of what I do. And they were talking to people about medicinal this, that, and the other.
and they ran to their car and brought me something. I looked at it. I didn't want to be offended, and I opened it up. And when I smelled it, I said, oh, hey, hey, hold on, Jesus. Hold on. Thank you, Jesus. I should have never opened that genie. See how y'all quiet? You should have never, ever took it. Hush, hush, hush. We're teaching how to overcome, and I believe I was approached so I could teach you how to maneuver after it's in your custody. How can you be a pastor with no experiences to help your congregation? Prophet McIntosh, it was for medicinal reasons. I stuck it in my... What you laughing at? Did you read this shirt? All right, now, you're going to be in one of these sermons in a minute. I took and put it in my pocket in their presence and forgot. I was driving home. I got to the third light, this is my hand of God, and I heard my pocket say, let me out. Because if I make it to your house, oh, y'all are quiet now. I could have given it away to somebody who needed it. I won't even assist. No alley-oops. I opened up my window, driving 50 miles an hour, and dropped it out the car. And this is what I literally said to myself at the next light for 10 folk who'll catch it. I said, boy, that was some good stuff. I'm sorry that I couldn't enjoy it. But see, some of you don't know how to admit it's good and not enjoy it. Look at some of y'all. What street was that on, Bishop? Wait. Ooh-wee. Even people that have much to lose, some people have lost it all and yet continue down their path of sin. They have now become addicted to pleasure. Pleasure not wrapped in a promise. See, I can't get help. When God tells you to do a thing, there's a promise and there's some joy to it at the end. When sin comes, it's all pleasure, no promises. I thought that was a powerful saying, but I'll go forward. I have found scripture where God will allow Satan to tempt us and then give Satan access to everything we own. And it is at that time a test. This is for mature saints. If you pass it, you must come out with more than you had when you started. Most of us, I'm halfway through now, are only inclined to do better after the sin we enjoyed worked against us. If you never got caught, you would have continued down that path. But once sin becomes a snitch, y'all ain't talking, once sin leaves you naked, now you want to become a better woman of God, a better man of God, a better praise singer, a better musician. Because right now she's pregnant, but it has not gone public. You know, right now you're going to court, but it has not been on the news. Sin threatens people. I'm going to read that line again because I know I'm helping at least 10 of you. I have found scripture where Satan has given, where God has given Satan permission to tempt us and access to all that we have acquired. If we pass that particular test, Hanshi, we must have more than we began with. I then gave examples last week that I want to quickly reiterate that I pulled from the internet, not because I was scared, but I don't want the whole world knowing my business. I'm still going to tell it. It's live right now. And I did not want to affect any of the people that I love who was a part of the scenario. But my sex in wedlock, not sinful sex, marital sex, cost me 17% after the divorce for child support, $687 times 12 months, which is a year, was $8,244. $8,244 times 18 years minimum was $148,392. If he went to college, y'all quiet now, then that price went up to $176,000, and that was legitimate error. Y'all miss it. That was legitimate error. That was not listening to wisdom and sound doctrine, being grown enough to do what I wanted to do when I wanted to do it. And when the mistake turned against me, it was $176,000. Some of you ain't never made that and will never make it. You ain't gonna never save it because you don't know how to stop sinning. So if I had that much to pay sin, I must be worth more than what I had. Now, y'all ain't gonna believe this because you ain't talking. I didn't know how I was paying that because I was broke at that time. And God started providing, not for my sin, but for my mistake. God does not replenish for sin. He will give you a refund if it was a mistake. A legitimate, y'all not clapping over, mistake. No one should have to keep paying for an honest. At the minimum, that $148,392 was for legitimate child marriage. And then later on, I had a child out of wedlock. They have to balance the two payments so that both children can be taken care of and that I can still have enough to at least get a sandwich. Yep. See, these kids don't know it till y'all get pregnant, but these kids don't know nothing. And the government is trying to make y'all live right by telling you in certain states, if you get pregnant, you cannot abort it. No plan B, C, D, E, F, G. Nothing. You're going to have to become responsible for the results that your sin birthed. I'm glad they clapped, but y'all didn't, huh? I'm glad God's making America holy. You crazy. Let's move on. America holy? America's is holy. Let's see who your holy president is. I had a child out of wedlock that I raised and took care of very well. That child cost $347 a month because the other one was $687. So my sin was half the bill. Y'all got quiet. Times 12 was $4,164. $4,164 times 21, because she went to college, was $87,444. I added that to my legitimate sin. Y'all ain't talking to me.
and I came up with $267,836. That's a whole house. That's a house with a car in the driveway. All right, y'all don't want to talk to me. Sin put me in debt to the future. I only wanted to bring up that part because I gave a lot of things, certain places that you should have never been seen in, what it costs, that those sins probably ran into six figures. I want to ask a question, and I want three people to be honest. Did y'all hear last week enough to be convicted enough to add up how much your sin has cost you? Now, I hear you saying, yeah, I'm about to ask you to tell me how much, because I hear you. See, you can't fool me. Did you get convicted enough and gain wisdom enough to go home and be like, let me add up a few things that I remember? And did you add up the grace of God that allowed your sin not to flourish where you didn't have to actually pay for it because the Lord allowed something to occur? Oh, you didn't do that either, huh? There are some sins I never paid for. Almost there. What do you do when self-righteous people see things going wrong in your life for a long time and they automatically tag it to sin? Those who are not spiritual, not discerning, not caring, not sensitive. Y'all could clap right there because we got a few in here right now. And they're so self-righteous, they're also broke, homeless, manless, womanless, childless, because you're mean. You're stuck in things that bring you no pleasure, no joy. So you're serious and serious faced about everything. I don't like jokes. What's wrong? A man told me today that a black man was walking down the street in a hearse had a coffin in it. He said when the man was walking, the coffin fell out the car. Said the black man started running and the coffin was following him. He said he started running faster and the coffin picked up speed and kept following him. He said he got to his house, walked in, went up the steps. The coffin broke through the door of the house, met him upstairs. He said he got mad, ran down the stairs, went to the kitchen. Coffin followed him to the kitchen. He got to the kitchen, opened the cabinet, and started throwing him some syrup, and he stopped coughing. See, when people... I can't believe they laughed at that dry joke. What do you call a preacher that's running a marathon? He's called the Reverend. He's a rev running. He's a Reverend. You see, some of you just slow. And all you that still look serious, you got a problem.
Everything wrong is not sin, but every sin is wrong. Can you say that after me? Everything wrong is not sin, but every sin, I don't care how pleasurable it is, it's still wrong. And some of you gonna hate this, but only three of you can stand if you are a student of the Word of God, which I will always be a student even while I'm a teacher. I need you to know some of you are terrible because you don't even know how to sin right. There's a sin right and there's a sin wrong. If you've never been to school, you will not understand that. Bishop, break it down. For what? You want to sin right? A sin that's unplanned that you get caught doing is wrong. When you plan your sin, you be like, when I get there, you come an hour later. If you see a certain car there, don't park. See, some of y'all think I don't know it. When I come in, if you see somebody swap my drink and put water in front of me, and you hold that. Knock three times on the ceiling if you want me. Now, if you really want to know how to sin right, ask the mothers. They can tell you. Because we can add up some of their oldest child and their wedding anniversary, and the two ages don't match. We need to know how you got a certain guy and kept him. You didn't pray. How you saved and married. Oh, let me get up out of here. How was your holy self attracted to that type of man? And went against your own family's wishes for that man. And gave your virginity away to a man who didn't deserve it at all. Y'all stop capping on these young people and start testifying. Because we are overcomers by the words of our testimony and then the blood. Your true story needs the blood for you to survive it. Let me say it again. Your real story needs an application of the blood of Jesus for you to survive the story. That's called being transparent. Some of you flaunt your transformation, but you don't flaunt your transparency. The key word in that is parent. Trans means clear, being able to look through. If I gotta look at you but never see the real you, you are not transparent. You might be transforming. But the movie song says, if you're a transformer, there's more to me than meets the eyes. So then it says, robots in disguise. You're in a disguise. Your holiness is a disguise. I might as well get in trouble. I was trying to not do this in front of the guests from Columbia, South Carolina. I was trying to be a part of the Bible Belt because I know they said this is a true prophet, and I am, but I'm in Bible study. I might as well let this out now for three folk who will jump. The holiest women in the church are the horniest women in the church. The most anointed man is the man with a sexual problem most of the time. Because there has to be something great to balance who you think you are to make you remember you are not God. Yeah, okay. What's after that? Where sin doth abound. I like this minister here. Grace doth more abound. That means for every sin, you don't need the same measure of grace. You need more grace. Pass down your aisle and see if they're friendly. Tell them more grace, more grace, more grace, more grace. That means that you're not sitting near them to judge them
or send them to hell, you're telling them at this time in your life, you are not strong enough to be as delivered as I am. So instead of me judging you, I give you more grace. And his grace is sufficient, for there his strength is made perfect in weakness. In Job 1, we're about to close. God gives Satan, because we're not going to read a lot, access, not just to his resources, come on, feel for him, but also to his relationships, which included his children, y'all don't feel, and his marriage. God says, all access granted. He lost his stock. He lost, and I wish my preachers would really be serious, because you don't know when God's going to tell Satan, try you. He lost his livestock. He lost his stock and bonds. He lost his businesses. He also lost his employees, and only one employee per trial lived, not to give him good news, but to give him the bad news. You've lost everything. Look, somebody tell me, I hope I never have to hear that news. You lost everything. We don't dance on Wednesday, but I feel one, because now it's getting personal. None of you should want to, and the ones that ain't talking, it's because you don't have enough to lose. You still living by faith. Some of us have made a living. You still living by faith. Some of us have made a living and trying to keep that living for our next generation. You still living on faith times zero. Am I boring y'all over there? I'd be blessed if people would just bless me for blessing them. You know what I get when I get folk out of hell? Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. But the mistake would have cost you everything. You get out of it, and a brother can't get none. You're a user. If some of you could just get paid for the people you helped, and you helped them with money you couldn't afford to give them, and they ask you because you don't look like the struggle that you're experiencing, so they think you have it. They give you a promissory note and it never comes to fruition. I'm gonna bless you if I get out of this, Pastor. You're a liar. See, I don't mind telling you. Some of you have the same disease I have. You can't help but help people. You have a good heart. And what's terrible about it, even when you try to change, God won't let you, because now you're living a counterfeit life. If God made you soft, stay soft. He made you hard, stay hard. But don't take on the nature that you're not. Payday is coming. Tell three people that. Payday is coming. You did the will of God. You are your brother's keeper. And if you saw that brother overtaken in the fault, you approached him with the spirit of meekness. They sinned against you. You were their gift from God. He lost all his children in one day. He lost all of his employees except three or four. One day. The stock market crashed and his went down to zero. One day. God even gave Satan dual access to where now he said, you can touch his body, but don't touch his soul. Y'all still quiet. And if you go to school, Job is laying down, living a life with 11 major diseases in one body. He's even wishing for death and cannot die. You know you special when what's killing others ain't killing you. And you know you're anointed when you want to die and God says, I still got something for you to live for. You're the only person in the dark. The one being attacked is the only person in the dark. I haven't heard from Elder Patty Jackson. I've heard from my young people. I've not heard from so many of you. It was good seeing Chantel back in her role as praise and worship leader tonight. But let me tell y'all something. Most of you that I pray for and close to, you are not too far from dying. You're not well enough to actually enjoy life. See, I'm a realist. I have ailments that I'm fighting that they say I don't have, but they keep me on prescriptions for that I believe is the reason why I'm sick, is I'm obeying the doctor. Some of you are doing worse than me. You can't climb steps. You can't run. You can't go to the gym. You can't even romance your spouse. There are some things that I don't see how you're happy. You're making your money late. And getting excited about possibilities. I don't want to be 70 when my season begins. Let's keep it real tonight. I wanted mine in my 30s. I asked for it in my teens. But I wasn't mature enough to know how to keep it. So God withheld it from me. Because he knows what's better for me than I know what's best for myself. But now he's releasing it. What's your maturity level? How long will you actually keep it? Charles Barkley was on television the day before yesterday, and he said that he was hanging out with the great, legendary Julius Erving. He said, Julius Erving, y'all don't like myself, came to one of his games, then Charles Barkley honored him. He said, Julius Erving asked him, what have you acquired with your money? He said, man, I drive this car, that car, that. It was four cars. Julius Erving said, how many can you drive? He said, one. Then Julius Erving told Charles Barkley a secret that changed his life for three people. He said, you do know all the money you made is all the money you're going to get. He said, this has to last you the rest of your life. Why four cars and you're renting a home? Why four cars and you haven't paid off half your home? Why four cars and why the restaurant got all your money when it's cheaper to buy groceries and take 2 hours and make a... Why?
I'll leave it alone. Get mad. Get mad. But I better not see you broke next year. Because I'm going to preach on you. Especially if you're mine. I'm going to get you. Brag about how good God's been, and then next year he ain't good no more. Show up with enough clothes that you ain't even got enough closet space. But you don't have a retirement fund. Try that. That's called sinning against yourself. I did something today, Deacon Etheridge, and then I'll leave it alone. I did something today. I said, how old do I want to live based upon how old I am and how much I think I would need a year for those days? Yeah, that's how you do it. And I said, I got to have this amount of money so I can live this many years. Then the Lord laughed at me in me. I could hear him. He just started laughing. And I know when it's him. I said, Lord, what's so funny? The Lord said, oh, you're only saving enough money for you? What if you marry her? You need some more money. What if I tell you to give away some of that? You need some more money. What if I tell you to build a new church and your church stingy and I need you to put the down payment on? You need some more. Oh, y'all done got quiet now. Any money held from God is sinful money. Any money you think is totally yours and he didn't provide it is sinful money. I'm not teaching on money, but you got quiet. God only gives wealth to folk who think about more than themselves and more than your kids. Lord, those who clap from a sincere place, eradicate their debt as quick as possible so that they will know that you're real. Job has lost everything. Somebody say everything. Is it actually everything? What he didn't lose is what some of you still have that should make you jump up quick. You still have your right mind, right? I may not have money, silver, gold, but I am clothed. Come on, talk to me. And I am absolutely in my right mind. But now after Job loses everything, let's read Job chapter 1, verse 20 through 22. Then one more chapter in Job and we're going home. Job chapter 1, verse 20 through 22. This is after he has lost what?
Everything.
But is what? Money. See, you forgot that quick. Then Job arose and rent his mantle, shaved his head, fell down upon the ground. This after he lost everything. He afflicted himself and worshiped. Oh, y'all, I told you. He afflicted himself, but he didn't let the affliction stop him from worshiping. I worship him when I had everything, and I'm going to worship him when I've lost everything. You all acting like you don't want to read. Stevie, thank you for pushing me. It's good to have you back. Then Job arose, rent his mantle, shaved off his hair, fell down upon the ground. And instead of complaining and crying and having a pity party, he did what the devil did not expect. He turned misery into worship. Look at your neighbor and tell him, turn misery into worship.
Because you see us shouting don't mean we got money. Because you see us smiling don't mean we got a roof over our head. But we're taking the posture that puts us in a place to receive double what we already had.
Don't y'all try to have no church.
When I tell you I have what I have, those who know me know I ain't bragging. I have it. But the victory is not what I have, is that it doesn't have me. It knows I'm going to bless God no matter what position my life has been in. I didn't start praising him when I got a house. I praised him when I slept in my car. Come here. Let me. I didn't praise him after I had my first $1,000 saved in a savings account. I praised him when I had to eat White Castles 3 days later. What's your story? I didn't have no aunts and uncles to say, come live with me. I had girlfriends who had apartments who said, stay here, but I refused to take my newly saved self in that posture. I wanted to, but I said no when I wanted to say yes, not because I was sinning, but because I was super holy, so I had to sleep in my car, wash my underarms at a gas station. Still went to work every day. My only food was from Wendy's, where I worked during lunchtime, and at night when I was the manager, they throw everything away. I took everything they threw away, shared it with me and my friends. They thought I was a baller. Success begins with allowing nothing to go to waste. Tell your neighbor, don't be wasteful. Job lost everything but his mind. Look at somebody and bless them. Tell them, I almost lost that. I ain't gonna lie to you. Tell them, I almost lost. I know I have. I never said nothing negative about God in public. But every now and then, one-on-one, I was like, what's up? I thought you could heal everything, supply needs. I went through an issue a year and a half ago when the doctor said, you've got 30% of your heart. I said, Lord, you done killed me. I've been preaching for you. How you let your boy go out like this? Get scheduled for the surgery. They go in my body, go in my heart, pull it out, talking about we ain't find nothing. God said, who you talking to now? The issue is, couldn't breathe, wheezing, afraid to dance, because they said you can drop dead at any day, can't go to the gym, can't do nothing physical, can't do a thing. And all y'all talking about, Bishop, we love you. You didn't even know my condition, nor did some of you care. You probably prayed, he gonna die. I'm still here. And it's by the grace. All right. Now, nobody told me that the road would be easy. But am I shandala behold? No. But I don't believe he's brought me this far or brought us thus far to leave us. Some through the waters,
some through the floods, some through great trials. But tell somebody, I made it because of the blood. Let's get ready to close. I got 5 minutes, 47 seconds. I'm going to hold it till Sunday, but let me tell y'all something. This is one of those days where some of you don't know what it costs to be where we are. You don't know what we lost, and then you also don't know the cost. We were reading Job. He rent his mantle, shaved his head, fell down on the ground, and he worshiped. And look at what came out of his mouth. We're almost done. Naked came I out of my mother's womb, and naked shall I return thither. Look what he says. The Lord gave, and the Lord have taken away. This is for 10 folk who will scream. He gave Satan no recognition. The only power the devil has is when you mention him. He actually has nothing to give but all to take. He's a loser living off of your stuff. The Bible said, and God said, Satan, Lucifer, thou wert the anointed, cherub. He said, until iniquity was found in your heart and thou hast sinned. Y'all ain't. Satan didn't create sin. He sinned. Y'all ain't. But the bigger story is iniquity, I want to teach, was found in his heart. And when iniquity was found in his heart, this is how you know he was a sinner. Those who will scream, because he wanted more than what God had to offer him. He said, I will exalt my throne above the throne of God. And he's making cheap deals with some of you, and you don't know you're making a deal with a scammer. He has nothing that he tells you he has. He's like a woman who says she can cook, but her food is only good to her. Yep, got quiet on that one yet. Well, praise the Lord. Now, you women that are acting real sly tonight who seeking husbands and things, why don't y'all, before you pray for him, go to cooking class? You really want a man? Go to the kitchen, learn how to cook. Look at her. What about men? We know how to cook. That's why we want one. I just saw women frown at their boyfriends. That's something wrong with you. Like something wrong with you for real. Something wrong that you don't want to put your food in his stomach. And you rather some other woman put, I got a woman, way over time, yeah, get me. She don't give me money, she give me a meal. I make the money. Where we going to eat? When we gonna eat at home? Then you complain about that restaurant. I didn't like it. Make what you like. I ain't never going there no more. Why we got dining rooms looking pretty and nobody ever sit in them? You know why we? Breakfast nooks and no breakfast. Grill outside and no barbecue. House looking pretty while we all hungry. What is going on? The kitchen is now a decoration.
I got three women in here. I'm a real prophet. I'm not going to bless you, but I'm going to expose you, because you're sitting there like, this ain't got nothing to do with what God. God told me come. That man is not saying what God said. No, 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 no. You don't want to hear what God has to say, because God don't give women husbands so you can stop fornicating and to help grow your little ministry. He gives you a husband to be a helpmeet. That's the Bible. We are not together to be prayer partners. We're there to get each other to heaven legally. Help me get to heaven. Oh, bless his holy name. The Lord said, naked came out of my mother's womb. This is what Job said. Naked shall I return. The Lord gave, the Lord taken away. Then he said, blessed be the name of the Lord. But look at 22. Then we're going to our last scripture and pick it up on next Wednesday. Somebody get happy on this exposed text. In all this, I'm going through all of this, and none of this has anything to do with sin. It has to do with what God allowed, not caused. Oh, y'all are quiet. And whenever you're going through something that's not attached to something you did wrong, there's double waiting for you at the end of the test. All right, I done made three women mad, but only two still angry. Stop. Let me aim at you a second time. See, you walked into a real apostles' church. You can't come in here playing. If you want to be married and you don't know how to smile, stay away from men. If your whole life is looking serious, you need to be serious by yourself. You are in a person's life to bring joy and laughter. A merry heart doth good like a medicine. If you're not happy, you make folks sick. Now that's the Bible. You want some more? Keep staring at me like that. Marriage is not for ministry. It's for two people. God did not give Adam and Eve a ministry. He gave them a garden. They had no church members. They ain't lay hands on nobody but each other. Even when they had children, they didn't lay hands on their children. They didn't rebuke the spirit of murder off their son. Relationship therapy on its way back, coming out of the church near you, but let's go back here. In all this, Job sinned not. So I'm going to ask the body of Christ, in particularly this church, stop judging people by trying to attach what's going wrong to an act of sin. It could be the test that they have to pass to get double, I don't hear nobody, on the other side. Between chapter 1 and we close, and chapter 42, which is the final chapter, which is more than 9 months, even though Job was in this condition, his physical health, 9 months is what they say in school. 6 and a half, talk to me, to 9 months. But if you get to the 42nd chapter, the 42nd chapter of Job's life is over 50 years. One chapter. Oh, yeah. Some of you, your story's too big for you to tell it all at once. They don't believe the little part. They won't believe the crazy part. That's why you're hurt, because you need somebody to believe this really happened to me. Because if they believe it happened, they wouldn't judge what's happening. Look at me. The last chapter, he has 7 more children, 3 daughters. It takes 9 months per child. They're grown. So that's another grown starts for them in the Bible at 30. That's when you can become a priest. That's why I don't call anyone in their 20s apostle. Young. Because Jesus didn't start ministry till 30. Joseph didn't get over the money till 30. David was anointed as a teen but didn't become king till 30. You don't sit as an immature person. That's why I said the oil went down the beard. You know how long it takes to grow a beard that hits the ground? That means maturity. Some of you are too clean-faced to be apostles. Too young, too immature. If you need a title to feel, now, sir, I don't know you, but I'll get to know you. If I ever got married, like I'm sure you are, but if I ever got married, right, I want to take my fine wife out to eat. I don't want to have to tell nobody that I'm married to her. I want to see men approach her. That's just me. I'm crazy. I want to, see, everybody got quiet. I hang out with a group of guys, but if a man approach their wives, they want to fight me, that, you know, that makes me excited. I'll be like, don't tell them yet. Because you don't have to tell them you're married to be married. It's the way she acts that will let them know I'm taken. And I like that. And after he disrespects her posture, then I want to walk over and tongue kiss her in front of him and be like, homeboy, you all right? You know, you got to have fun with this life. See, got quiet again. Oh, you got to be holy. Don't kiss in public, prophet. Oh, watch me. Watch me. I'm going to put that on Facebook Live. I can tell you how short a black marriage will work by how fast they kiss at the altar. Kiss the bride. Mwah. That's going to be a short marriage. But you want to see a long marriage? Let them do this. And the preacher be like, save that till later. No, pastor. I've been waiting on it. No. My love didn't start on the cruise. It started at the altar. All right, let's get back. So, Job's last chapter. And let's go. Job's last chapter lasted, they say, a minimum of 30 years. So I want to read it to you, but between chapter 1 and 41, read it when you have time. 10 of you will say amen after you hear this. Job had 3 best friends. Those 3 best friends came to Job and said, the Lord showed them that he's in this condition because he sinned. See how y'all missed that? Job's 3 friends, best friends. One of them even said an angel came. Because they couldn't find anything else to blame it on. If you're so anointed, why do you have cancer? I'm so anointed that I survived it. You know, you got, what you mean? If he'd have gave it to you, you probably would have died. But he knew who to let Satan have. And it ain't you. You freaking out over a cheating boyfriend. You're going to really die over cancer. They said it. So let's go to Job chapter 42. Read this. No more comments. We're going home. Put it on screen, please. And And the Lord turned the captivity of Job when he prayed for his friends. Y'all missing it. He didn't get his full healing or get back into his season until he could forgive who misjudged him. Uh-oh. Some of y'all just find out where your season stuck. It's stuck in a place called unforgiveness. You got a better job and still in debt. Who have you not forgiven? Who are you holding a grudge against? Who are you now ignoring like they don't live and not present? What are you doing? I want to read it. Turn the captivity of Job. When he prayed for his friends. It's only three of them. Also, the Lord gave Job, y'all not happy on this? Twice as much. But this was after he forgave being misjudged by his friends. Some of y'all got a lot of work. I see it. You got a lot of work. People like Chantel, that once she threw at you, she threw. She got a lot of work. I know my members. People like Patty, you heard her. She'll act like you don't even exist no more and walk right by you. I don't care how holy none of us are. Some of us are professionals at cutting you off. But to cut them off is to cut off your money too. Now I want to talk to you about this. You get paid for representing God, not yourself. And Jesus is Lord, and the wealthiest commodity we've ever seen, that's a word that's too weak, because he said, Father, forgive them. Oh, y'all, they know not what they do. That should be your prayer. Look at y'all. Some of you clapping because you're getting healed. Others ain't because, I'm through. Be through. You're broke, too. You're struggling, too. Your car need work. You're living in a zip code you hate. Your children are hard-headed because you walk with a spirit of unforgiveness. One of the biggest sins is not being able to forgive someone. Once you hurt me, I'm through. Who are you? So what about when you hurt somebody? The Lord turned the captivity of Job when he prayed for his friends, and the Lord gave Job twice as much as he had before. Go on to verse 11. Then came there unto him all his brethren, all his sisters, y'all ain't saying nothing, and all what? They that had been of his acquaintance before and did eat bread with him. Oh, you hung around me while I was bawling, while I was the man. Oh, you're coming back because you see the return of my season, right? Oh, yeah. They ate bread with him and they bemoaned him, comforting him all over the evil. Look what it says, that the Lord brought upon him. Some of you don't look good. You look real. Let's go to the last verse. Every man also gave him. Uh-oh. Because my next level of you being my friend don't come free. I'm not going to be the only one giving in the relationship no more. All right, everybody's quiet. That part of me is dead. Y'all ain't saying. Every man gave him a piece of money, everyone an earring of gold. Next verse. Let's see if you get happy. Then I need to backtrack. So the Lord blessed the latter end of Job more than his beginning, for he had 14,000 sheep, 6,000 camels. Y'all ain't with me. And 1,000 yoke of oxen and 1,000 she-asses. Go to the next verse. He also had 7 sons, y'all ain't with me, 3 more daughters. Go to the next verse. And he called the name of the first Jemima, like Aunt Jemima, and the name of the second Keziah, and the name of the third Karen Hapuk. Verse 15, and in all the land were no woman found so fair as the daughters of Job, and their father gave them inheritance among their brethren. 16 and 17, after this, Job lived another 140 years, enough to see his sons and his sons' sons, even four. Who could ask for anything more than this? Job died being old. He exhausted life. Life did not extinguish him. Let me say it again. He exhausted life. But life did not extinguish him. Now, I need y'all to be kind to me, and let me show y'all something. Thank you, Dr. Sanders. Thank you, Living Waters Christian Worship Church Center, for coming here. Go back to verse 8 of Job 42. Just indulge me. Indulge me, because I don't like lying to my people. Go to verse 6. Indulge me. Go to verse 6. Ready? Yes. Wherefore I abhor myself and repent in dust and ashes. Watch now. Verse 7. Let's keep moving. And it was so that after the Lord had spoken these words to Job, the Lord said to Eliphaz the Temanite, who was his best friend, my wrath is kindled against you and against the other two friends. Oh, yeah. You think God ain't gonna hold a meeting with who mistreated you? Before you get your money, God's gonna visit your past, because he wants to talk to your past. Oh, you didn't read it. You didn't read it. You're so busy defending yourself when you should just be looking forward. You delay your destination talking to failure. You better look at this. It was so that after the Lord had spoken these words unto Job, the Lord, said to Eliphaz the Temanite, my wrath is kindled against you and against your two friends, because you have not spoken of me the thing that is right as it pertains to my servant Job. You made his struggle worse by not being there for him and making me seem like I'm the one tempting him. Next verse, let's see. Therefore, take unto you now 7 bullocks, 7 rams. Go to Job. Offer up for yourselves a burnt offering. He just told them, go make it right and don't go empty-handed. Your past ain't coming back to you without a check. Accept the check, don't accept the past. Y'all ain't talking. I just want to tell you how this goes. It's up to you how you want to do it. Therefore, take unto you now 7 bullocks, 7 rams. Go to my servant Job. Offer up for yourselves a burnt offering, and my servant Job shall pray for you, for him will I accept. Now let me look at you, because we're closing in 2 verses. 3 of you talked to me because you actually learned something tonight and you weren't just being a part of a formality. God tells Job to pray for them after he tells them Job will. So the deal was based upon Job praying for them, but they had to go and ask for prayer. No, he said Job will. Some of you are waiting for the pastor to ask. No, no, don't ask. Humble yourselves. Treat them right even when they treat you wrong. God's going to double your check because you did something you did not want to do. Not just something you didn't want to do, something a regular human being would not have done. That's how I know I'm maturing, because I'm doing some things that make me question myself. I feel like Urkel. Did I do that? I really feel like Urkel. He will pray for you. For him will I accept, lest I deal with you after your folly, which means if you don't go make it right, I'm going to take care of you. In that ye have not spoken of me, come on, the thing which is right, like my servant Job. Verse 9, and then we're done. So Eliphaz, the Temanite, Bildad, the Shuhite, Zophar, the Naamathite, went and did according as the Lord commanded them, and the Lord also accepted Job. Next verse is where we landed. And the Lord turned to captivity. You don't just get a season without a responsibility. You got to learn to swallow your pride. You got to learn to do what you were told, not what you feel. Because it will determine how much you get back. I'm blessed because I bless them that curse me. Even three in my own church. I still bless you. I know you dogging me out. I know you are. But you can't stop the blessing. I do good to them that despitefully use me and say all manner of evil against me falsely for his name's sake. For great is my reward in heaven. This doesn't just happen. It takes time. Maturity does not happen overnight. Did you learn anything tonight? Are you pleased with the Bible study tonight? Are you going to work on yourselves to be better? All standing, get your seat ready. I'm working on the building. It's a sure foundation. I'm holding up the bloodstained banner for my Lord. And listen, Waldron, when I get through working on that building, I'm going up to heaven to get my reward. Shabbat, I can't tell visitors what to do, but I can suggest to the visitors, but to those that I supervise, you have to work on your attitudes. You have to work on your perception of people. You have to say, I used to be that, but look at what I am now. And if God can do it for me, I don't hear nobody talking, then why can't he do it for someone else? And you cannot choose who he do it for. My gift of prophecy, I don't talk about it much, or my office as a prophet, my ability to see for God is so pristine that it scares me. I don't hear you talking. Help the baby real quick. It scares me. Oh, that's a visitor? Don't worry then. Let him cry. But it is so pristine, Kevin, that it scares me. But the only reason why my gift is a little more, I don't know how to say it, mature than other prophets is because God told me, I will use you and show you things you've never seen as long as you will say exactly what I tell you to say and who to say it to. Hold on. I said, yes, Lord. Until he had me prophesying blessings to my haters. Yes,
until he told me to speak a new house and things on my ex-wife. Till he told me to speak great ministry over people who were trying to kill the ministry that they came from. God had to make a deal with me, and he said, the more you can do this, the more accurate you will become. Some of you have a gift, but really the gift has you because you operate with the spirit of unforgiveness. You're holding a grudge that you should have been over by now. If y'all have not been together in 10 years, why do you frown when people mention his name? It shouldn't even bother you. You say any of my exes' name, I'd be like, I hope they're doing good. Some of them married. I'm friends with their husbands. Their husband be asking me stories. Did you have to put up with this with her? Yeah, doc. Because they know I'm no threat to the relationship. Why do some of you still have emotional connections to something you said you're through with? Answer, it's simple. You're not through with it. You're through with it physically. But emotionally, there's some soul ties there. Like if you walk in and they're eating with somebody, you walk out and eat somewhere else. If I walk in to see my past eating, I'm going to get me a table. I'm going to eat. That's what I went there for. Some of y'all can try me. We've talked. Let me go where you at and you be with somebody else and see if I don't come shake both of your hands. I'll even pay for your meal. Because I know how that looks when the test is over. I don't want to sound like a thug because I had a shirt on saying I'm half hood, so I swapped the shirt out. That was the original shirt that I wore to church. Half holy, half hood. And the assistant pastor bought that one for me. So I want y'all to know that my best friend bought that shirt. And then my other best friend bought this shirt. I don't know what subliminal message they're trying to say about me, but I'm a wham. I got something I'm buying you too in a little while. And I want you to wear it on a Sunday morning. God bless your life. I'm over it. Look at two or three people. Mean it so the process of deliverance can start, so your dollars can come back like they should, and tell your neighbor, I'm over it. I'm just over it. I'm over it. My ex said, I hear you're coming to Charlotte to preach for Bishop Hezekiah Walker in August. The actual real me wanted to say, hear me, you never supported my ministry when we were together. Why are you talking to me about my preaching? That's what Todd the thug wanted to say. The Lord says, speak to her in my words. And I said to God, your words should be like mine. See, you saw how I was treated. What you mean? You got something different to say? He said, yeah, he said, tell her what time you're going to get there, and then tell her that when the limo picks you up, you want her to meet you at a place to eat. And this is, I want to make you very wealthy, so I need you to have a better conversation with your yesterday. He said, and when you get her from the table, let her leave feeling great, and I'll make you greater. So I got to, no, ain't going to be easy. I got 2 months to work on this. See, y'all don't understand. I got 2 months to be like, oh. Because I'm not a hypocrite. I can't lie. I'm going to submit my spirit and my person to Jesus Christ and tell him, you need to do this. Because when I sit there, all I see is how I was treated. He said, sit there and see how I'm going to treat you.
Some of y'all ain't got to go eat. You ain't got to get no limousine to your past. But you owe them a proper conversation that displays God's love. And then get to stepping. Because after that dinner, there will be no more dinners forever and ever. Amen. You go to dinner after you forgive them, you want them back. Y'all hold hands and let's talk about it. Look at folk got quiet. Did y'all really learn something today? Wednesday is my favorite day. You want to love on me? Bring me visitors and more people on Wednesday. I want to help our church get better. I want to help you get better. I want the world to be better because of you. If you want the world to be a better place to live in, try a little love. Show a little peace. That's an old song. If you want the world to be a better place to live in. See, y'all don't know that. It's old. Very old. Very smooth, though. I like it. Yeah. See, I heard it back there. Try a little love. Try a little peace. Show a little love. Show a little peace today. And we were told we were going to hell by the old saints for singing that song. Andre Crouch made so many songs. Then the Winans came and commission came. We were all going to hell. The Cloth Sisters was going as soon as they made that one song. And it went on FM radio to the club. Just too much judgment. I want everybody to get a good seed, whatever good looks like for you tonight, whatever it looks like for you on tonight. Sow into the ministry, sow into the word of